Hey everybody, Mike Giardina with CrossFit Health here at the Symposium for Metabolic Health in San Diego, California. And I have a really amazing guest here with me, Dr. Stephen Phinney, who is a founder and continuing advisor for Virta Health, also author of many books, including The Art and Science of Low Carb Living, The Art and Science of Low Carb Performance, and the list goes on. And well, first off, thank you so much, Dr. Phinney, for being here with us and spending some time talking to us and, mm-hmm. and the CrossFit community. Mm-hmm. We're going to talk a little bit about inflammation, yeah?
Yes.
Awesome. So, you know, I think we can jump right into this. And I think what would be a great starting point is defining, as quickly and concisely as we can, like what is inflammation generally, and then we'll go into good inflammation versus bad inflammation.
Okay, so inflammation is a very complex biological process mm-hmm. that has multiple layers,
sure.
and there's an alphabet soup of all these different active components of inflammation that are made by different cells and in different tissues in the body. That it's so complex that most people avoid it like the plague.
Right.
But it's absolutely essential for our health and our survival in moderation.
Right.
But, and when we are acutely injured or have an acute infection,
right.
it will become, the inflammation is what drives a fever, what
right.
makes a damaged piece of tissue swell up.
Sure.
But that's required for the healing process to save our lives. But if it occurs in great excess, mm-hmm. it can be fatal. And one of the really sad things we've seen with COVID, for instance, is people who have already underlying chronic inflammation, particularly people with diabetes
sure.
and other inflammatory diseases, when they got COVID, they would have this acute, they call it a inflammatory storm.
Right.
Or a cytokine storm.
Yeah, yeah, right.
Cytokines are some of the mediators of inflammation
sure.
that would cause organs to shut, like the lungs and heart, to shut down and be fatal. So we have to have it to survive. We have to have it recover to recover from major stresses and trauma.
Even exercise. But,
including exercise. But it has to be modulated, controlled over the longer period of time to keep it at a level where it doesn't cause cumulative damage in the body.
Interesting. So when we think about a subset of people that have metabolic disease, they're in a state of chronic inflammation. Is that what we would,
yes.
how we can describe
yeah.
that? And
but it's not so high that they have a fever.
Right.
So it's low grade.
Chronic low grade inflammation.
Chronic low grade inflammation. So if your baseline level was say 1 or 2, not picking any particular measurable
yeah,
compound, but 1 or 2, if you have an acute injury, let's say you get a lung infection, you have pneumonia,
yeah.
your inflammatory level might go to 10 or 20.
Right.
But then as you conquer the infection, maybe you get an antibiotic and knock the infection down. Then it should, within a week or two, it should be back down to 3 or 4. And then as that inflamed tissue finally completely repairs, you're back down to 1 or 2 after a couple of weeks.
Okay.
You don't want it to be 3 or 4 long term.
Okay.
So at 3 or 4, you don't have a fever.
Right.
But that over many months and years, because underlying that is that inflammation, it causes tissue damage.
Sure.
And that chronic cumulative tissue damage can lead to organ damage that we see in diabetic people with diabetes, such as vascular disease, damage to nerves, damage to kidneys, damage to heart.
Would it be similar to thinking about like a almost like a scab or a scar that is happening internally on tissue? Like how would that, when I think of like atherosclerosis or something like that, would that be something that could be a result of chronic low-grade inflammation inside the...
It's associated with trying to figure out the difference or the relationship between association and causality,
right, right.
but they're certainly there.
Yeah.
But there may be a common factor that leads to inflammation being up and tissue damage to occur, but there's something we're not seeing one layer below that.
Interesting.
And we don't want to get too far into that.
No.
Because that's why I got a PhD.
Let's talk for days.
MD in terms of what can help people understand this and deal with it properly.
So let's talk about different ways that we can, you know, for lack of a better description, fight off chronic inflammation. And one of the things that you were talking about is actually using different, you know, dietary approaches, one being the ketogenic diet. Can you explain how the ketogenic diet will allow us to fight off this chronic low-grade inflammation?
Sure. Well, the thing that most people are aware of is there are anti-inflammatory drugs that we physicians like to prescribe.
Yeah.
Some of them are over-the-counter, like non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, NSAIDs, like Motrin and Aleve, and ibuprofen, but those focus on one single component of the inflammatory process, which means their effects are limited, but also the risk of taking them is not very high, so they can be used chronically. Although I don't advise that.
Right.
And then there are the very profound inflammatory things like steroids.
Yes.
So if somebody has a chronic inflamed joint or something, the team coach will inject it with steroid, and you can play for a couple of days or a week.
Cortisone shot.
But then it comes back. Mm-hmm. And you can't stay on steroids long term because they have major side effects.
Catabolic to some extent.
Well, catabolic, that type of, the anti-inflammatory steroids are catabolic, but they also cause insulin resistance and make diabetes worse.
It's essentially similar to cortisol, right?
So those are medications that are they're used, but we don't have any that are very powerful that can be taken long term because of the side effects.
Right.
Which brings us to nutritional ketosis.
Yeah.
Because the first patient I ever put on the ketogenic diet was during my medical training. So even as a trainee, I was very interested in this because I thought it was dangerous because there was no carb and it would starve the body of essential things and so on. So I came at it to prove the Dr. Atkins approach. I came at it to prove him wrong in 1975.
Really?
His first book came out in 72.
Yeah.
It was very popular. But what we observed with ketogenic diets was surprising, and that is people who had inflammatory diseases like inflammatory arthritis, like arthritis, rheumatoid arthritis, or associated inflammatory arthritis where they would be taking chronic drugs with side effects.
Yeah.
And when some of the patients were on a ketogenic diet, they came off their drugs.
Interesting.
And it was like, how can that be?
Yeah.
And so it's been observed over, and that was in the early 70s and 80s and into the 90s, and we didn't really understand, I didn't understand how this could work. I mean, what is it about cutting out carbs and going into nutritional ketosis that was anti-inflammatory? And the answer was published in the highly respected journal Science in January of 2013, were some people who had no dog in the ketogenic diet fight.
Really?
Who were studying the effects of beta-hydroxybutyrate, the primary ketone we have circulating in our blood, on cell function. And what they discovered is that beta-hydroxybutyrate is not just a great fuel for the brain. So, you know, you can drop your blood sugar really low, but you have ketones there, your brain functions fine, your heart functions fine, and to some extent they can be used by muscles for fuel. So we thought it's a great alternative fuel, because I've got 60,000 calories that I can turn into brain and heart fuel.
So
I don't need to be eating carbs, right? So that's what we thought was the great thing about this. But there was also this observation, besides improving arthritis, that the ketogenic diet in many people with seizures is a very effective tool to reduce or completely block seizures. And we didn't know how that worked in the brain. So in this paper that was published in Science by a group of very respected scientists associated with the University of California, San Francisco, they pointed out that beta-hydroxybutyrate actually acts as a gene expression altering signal. That there are certain genes that we have that, most of the genes we have aren't working at any one time.
Right.
And they're suppressed because they're wrapped in a certain kind of protein called the histone. Yeah. And those histones, when they're wrapped around the gene doesn't work. It doesn't, it's not expressed. When there are a certain group of genes that when you give them a level of ketones that you have circulating in our blood right now, it allows those blocking proteins to unwrap and those genes to turn on. And it turns out that set of genes, through the action of this histone deacetylase enzyme suppression, it really sounds, it's a very complex backward process, but when you suppress this enzyme, the genes, the wrap unravels and they're expressed, and these genes provide us an antioxidant defense that we normally, if we don't have if we're eating carbohydrates.
Interesting.
So when we eat carbohydrates, these genes that are antioxidant functions in the body aren't active.
Wow.
And so here's the provocative thing. That may explain why we have to take antioxidants.
Interesting.
You know, dietary antioxidants when we're eating carbs. But we know from Arctic explorers and Aboriginal peoples, Aboriginal, you know, long-standing cultures, whether they were pure hunters or whether they were herders and hunters who didn't farm and didn't eat carbs much of the year, how could they not get scurvy because of vitamin C deficiency? And there was an infamous Arctic explorer who lived among the native peoples in the Arctic, among the Inuit, for up to 2 years at a time. And back in the early 1900s, and he came back and said, I could go for 2 years without eating any vegetables at all. And that was unfortunately right at the time when all the vitamins between 1914 and 1928, all the 12 known vitamins were discovered and characterized.
Yeah.
And this guy said, I don't need to eat fruits and vegetables. And they knew he was lying. So they basically, in order to salvage his reputation, this guy permitted himself to be locked up in a experiment where he ate only meat and fat for a year. Yeah. And for the first 4 months, he was under 24/7 observation. And they knew that within 2 or 3 months of not eating any vitamins, anything with vitamin C, he developed scurvy. But he didn't. And we never knew why. And now it appears that nutritional ketosis, to a great extent, enables the body's endogenous antioxidants to provide us with that protection. But the neat thing about this level of antioxidant protection is that it prevents oxidative damage to membranes and certain polyunsaturates and fats in the membranes that when they're damaged by this oxidative stress, it becomes pro-inflammatory agents throughout the body.
Interesting.
Now, this may explain, among other things, why exercise, where your muscles use a lot of oxygen, now, and if you do vigorous exercise, that can lead to enough oxidative damage, the muscle becomes inflamed.
Yeah.
Now, you don't want that to go on for a long time.
Right.
But the neat thing is that evolutionarily, that inflammation in the muscle, muscle recovers, the muscle gets stronger. So that's actually a stimulus to improve muscle strength and resilience.
Okay.
But then you want that inflammation to go away.
Yeah.
The interesting thing that you may have heard, and people may have heard, is that for athletes who do extreme intensities or durations of sports, that if they are keto adapted and they go through or on the keto diet, not for a few days or weeks, but months, that their post-exercise inflammatory response is reduced, and the time they need for recovery, say after a marathon or after an ultra-marathon event or an Ironman, their recovery time is truncated, probably because of the protective effects of ketones.
How do you think that applies to like a CrossFit athlete who maybe they're not doing something so, you know, cyclical in nature for longer periods of time, but, you know, intensity levels that tend to fluctuate from really high to a little bit lower, like interval training or resistance training, or something that may go on for 20, 30 minutes to an hour, but rotating through different types of movements. How do you think, or do you think, I should say, the ketogenic diet could be beneficial to CrossFit performance?
To the extent, so nutritional ketosis does not, the degree of modulation of inflammation does not prevent the muscle, positive muscle response to right. high intensity exercise.
Okay.
So people, when we've done training studies with people on ketogenic diet, they get as good a training response as somebody who's following eating a high carbohydrate diet,
okay.
but probably having somewhat more symptoms.
Right.
Okay?
Okay.
But the neat thing about the ketogenic diet is that if somebody does something which results in a greater degree of stress where the inflammation might cause, impair the training intensity or training frequency, then you can maintain the intensity or the frequency at a higher level. I won't mention names. There was a famous downhill skier who about a decade ago was dominating women's downhill skiing.
Yeah.
And she basically, after 3 to 4 years of being at a very high level of competition, seemed to actually blossom even more and then extended her career for another 4 years. And it came out later that she had switched to a low carb.
Interesting.
But we never found out exactly what her program was because, you know, that's a proprietary secret.
Oh, it
was
an Olympic
athlete? But what she said was by cutting out most of the carbs in her diet, and we don't know if she was pure keto or whatever, mm-hmm. She said, you know, the season starts in the fall, early fall, the downhill skiing in the early fall, and goes until late spring. It's a long season. It's like 6-7 months long. And you have to maintain peak at that.
Sure.
And she said, this allowed me to out-train my competitors because I could train twice as hard and not get into a slump after, you know, by training too hard. So she avoided overtraining. Said it prevented her from being overtrained.
I love it. So let me backtrack to one thing you did say is you might have more symptoms. So do you mean discomfort while training? Is that what you meant by symptoms?
Sure.
So, okay, so that's a great point. So, and then we can close after that. But so any athlete, but I'm going to talk specifically about a CrossFit athlete. So CrossFit athletes, first there's an adaptation phase. Then there's this understanding that, hey, there might be some, you know, higher symptoms of discomfort from the training, but the long-term effect is the ability to maintain a higher training intensity for longer periods of time. And I don't mean within the workout itself, but maybe that
it's
is
it's your long-term training volume
over
is
time.
Is enabled.
Right.
Is enabled.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Well, I think that's a huge point and probably a big misconception in the understanding of using the ketogenic diet for performance and CrossFit. Because I always tend to think, well, there are a couple of things. You know, one thing is the majority of the people who are now coming to CrossFit gym probably have, well, they're the general population. And what we know about the general population is a lot of the general population has some underlying metabolic condition.
Yep.
Right? So, yes, I want their performance to increase, but at the same time, I want some of their, you know, I want them to have a healthier metabolism.
Sure.
Extent, right?
Which means avoiding insulin resistance.
Exactly.
And a well-formulated ketogenic diet reduces insulin resistance
100%.
From higher norm, you know, above normal levels down to normal.
Yeah.
And, you know, insulin still has a critical role to play in the body, but we need a lot less of it to be healthy.
Right. Yeah. So we can use it. General population coming in can use it to become more metabolically healthy, lose weight, which will inevitably increase performance. But even on the higher end of things, we can use it with an understanding of, yes, there may be some more, one, there's an adaptation phase, there may be a more, you know, discomfort or symptoms during training, but you're going to be able to have an extended training volume.
Sure.
Right, which will inevitably increase performance for longer periods of time.
And any situation where you're having to lift or move your body,
yeah.
as opposed to standing there and lifting something,
yeah.
power to weight ratio is very important.
Huge.
And again, people, performance athletes have been able to, you know, reduce their body fat content by about 1 or 2 kilos.
Yeah.
Which sounds like very little.
Well, that's big.
But if you're in a competition sport.
Oh, gymnastics.
Yeah.
Strength to weight and gymnastics. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Making weight in terms of weight category.
For sure.
And my co-founder of Virta and my research colleague, Dr. Jeff Volek, was in graduate school, a competitive powerlifter.
I didn't know Jeff.
He struggled to make weight.
Interesting.
He'd have to go and sit in the sauna and sweat himself down and volume deplete himself, which isn't healthy and doesn't improve your performance.
Yeah.
And he had a hard time getting under like 12% body fat, which is low, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
But when he went keto and got down to 9%,
interesting.
That means he could have 2 kilos more muscle and still make weight.
Amazing. I didn't know that was the background behind Dr. Volek's experience.
Yeah, Jeff, I shouldn't have revealed that, but...
That's cool.
But
that's,
yeah, really that, cool. That's really the thing that convinced him that this was an important physiological tool. And it's naturally, we do it without drugs.
That's a massive part of this.
Well, and for me as a doctor, just a physician, to say we do it without drugs, as I say that with pride.
Yeah.
Because that's really what good medicine is about.
100%. Absolutely. This has been absolutely eye-opening for me. Thank you so much for taking your time and talking to us.
Well, thank you, Mike, and thank you for the chance to talk to your audience.
Of course. Thank you so much. It's been great.